social distance, but still have fellowship. Be together as united as brothers and sisters in Christ. And it's a joy. My heart is pumping at the moment. And it's doof. Nervous because of doing it this way. You know, I haven't spoken to people in like this for, what's it, 3 months now? It's odd looking at people. I'm so used to looking there at that thing and just talking to that and realizing that it doesn't give any response back. That I've got to try and show emotion to an emotionless thing. But it's good to be able to fellowship together, to come and see smiles, to see happy faces, and to join together. And as we come, there's millions of mickeys around you today. That's fine. But as we come into God's presence knowing that He is with us, that we can worship Him, that we can praise Him, no matter where we are or how we find ourselves, but we can do it as a body of believers, united in Christ. I just want to read some selected verses from Psalm 147 as we start. Praise the Lord. How good to sing praises to our God. How delightful and how fitting. How great is our Lord. His power is absolute. His understanding is beyond comprehension. The Lord supports the humble. He brings the wicked down into the dust. Sing out your thanks to the Lord. Sing praises to our God with a harp. He covers the heavens with clouds. He provides rains for the earth. And He makes the grass grow in the mountain pastures. He gives food to the wild animals and feeds the young ravens when they cry. He takes no pleasure in the strength of a horse or in human might. No, the Lord's delight is in those who fear Him, those who put their hope in His unfailing love. Praise the Lord. Let's start by singing. If you've got your phones with you, we're singing the first song, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassion they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to Thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and peace that endureth, Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blameless is mine with 10,000 beside. Blessings. Oh, great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning, my morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Heavenly Father, you are our Creator and you are our Sustainer God. And you call us from our everyday to this special day, set aside for rest and for worship. And Lord, we confess that we often find it hard to do either very well. But here we are, and that's half the battle won. So please accept this time as our gift of worship to you. We know that our relationship with you is not a one-sided one, and that while we are giving of ourselves, you are giving as well. Let us receive all that you offer to us in worship. We open our hearts to receive your love, and our minds and our ears to receive your word. No one understands the weight and the worries that we carry individually better than you do, and you've promised to take our burdens if only we would give them to you. And Father, forgive us of our stubbornness as we try to go it alone. Increase our trust in you to handle all that comes our way. Help us through your Holy Spirit to see opportunities in things around us. You're already there, not as an uninterested observer, but as a loving parent, wholly invested in us and in the circumstances that we're facing. And hear our prayers today, Father, for the burdens that we carry and the challenges that we face. For the health concerns, Father, give us strength and healing. For fear of the future, give us assurance and direction. For loss of hope, give us a vision to see all the good that you have planned for us, just as your word promises. Help us to look forward with anticipation as we remember who you are and all that you have already done for us. Father, we think of especially of Gail and France this morning, and we pray for your love and your comfort to surround them as they mourn the passing of Gail's brother. Be with them, Father. Hold them in your arms. Let your love flow into them. And Father, thank you for all our freedoms, especially that we can worship you freely. And thank you that we can gather again as a people called by your name. We praise you, Lord. But Father, confession is not an easy or a pleasant thing to do. I'd like to think that we have been good and faithful disciples, following your way. But we know in our hearts the many ways in which we've turned our backs on you and rejected your will for us. Like the people in the wilderness, we create for ourselves idols and we worship them, only to discover their shallowness and their emptiness for our lives. And then we wonder what went wrong. So stop us in our tracks, O Lord. Help us to be open to your will for our lives. We know what you want us to do. So give us the persistence and the courage to do your will. Heal us from our wayward actions and our attitudes. Remind us that we must reach out to others in compassion and peace. Merciful God, come to us this day with your healing power and help us again to be your disciples, offering hope and peace to your hurting and wounded world. And fill us, Holy Spirit, with so much love and grace that it cannot help but pour out of us the broken vessels that we are. And thank you for who you are, for your faithfulness, for your grace, for your love. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your constant companionship. And thank you, Jesus, for being our closest friend and our Savior. And it's in your precious name that we pray together the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray, as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let's join and sing together, Lord, I come to you.
Lord, I come to you, let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Bring me near, draw me to your side, and as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love. Lord, unveil my eyes, let me see you face to face, the knowledge of your love as you live in me. Lord, renew my mind as your will unfolds in my life, in living every day. By the power of your love, so hold me close, let your love surround me. Bring me near, draw me to your side, and as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love.
Thank you, Father, that it is through the power of your love and not through anything that we can do ourselves that you lead us, that you guide us, and that you strengthen us. Amen. Some notices as we go through here. There's a couple of wedding anniversaries this week. 30th is Pierre and Rina, and then on the 3rd is Dean and Camelia, and then we have birthdays. Brian, it's your birthday on the 1st. Where are you, Brian? Yay. Happy birthday. God blessing for you on that day. And then on the 4th, it's Edna's birthday. And then just regards the collection, on the way, if you drive out around this way, down, I can't see it now, it's hiding. I think it's hiding behind McQueen's there. There's the little table with a box on it. It says tithes and offerings on it. There's a hole in the top. Welcome just to put in there as you drive out. Okay. And we give thanks to God for his bounty and his goodness that he gives to us. So our reading this morning is taken from Acts chapter 8, verse 1 to 25. Acts chapter 8, verse 1 through to 25. And we pick up the narrative after the stoning of Stephen. And at that stoning, as we read in verse 1, and Saul was there, giving approval to his death. On that day, a great persecution broke out against the church at Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. Godly men buried Stephen and mourned deeply for him. But Saul began to destroy the church. Going from house to house, he dragged off men and women and put them in prison. Those who had been scattered preached the word wherever they went. Philip went down to a city in Samaria and proclaimed the Christ there. When the crowds heard Philip and saw the miraculous signs that he did, they all paid close attention to what he said. And with shrieks, evil spirits came out of many, and many paralytics and cripples were healed. So there was great joy in that city. Now for some time, a man named Simon had practiced sorcery in the city and amazed all the people of Samaria. He boasted that he was someone great, and all the people, both high and low, gave him their attention and exclaimed, "This man is the divine power known as the Great Power." They followed him because he had amazed them for a long time with his magic. But when they believed Philip, as he preached the good news of the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Simon himself believed and was baptized. And he followed Philip everywhere, astonished by the great signs and miracles he saw. When the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them. When they arrived, they prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit had not yet come upon any of them. They had simply been baptized into the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John placed their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. When Simon saw that the Spirit was given at the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money and said, "Give me also this ability so that everyone whom I lay my hands on may receive the Holy Spirit." Peter answered, "May your money perish with you, because you thought that you could buy the gift of God with money. You have no part or share in this ministry, because your heart is not right before God. Repent of this wickedness and pray to the Lord. Perhaps he will forgive you for having such a thought in your heart. For I see that you are full of bitterness and captive to sin." Then Simon answered, "Pray to the Lord for me, so that nothing you have said may happen to me." When they had testified and proclaimed the word of the Lord, Peter and John returned to Jerusalem, preaching the gospel in many Samaritan villages. Give thanks to God for his word. And the fact that it's not just an old book, but it's a book of relevance for each and every one of us today. Is this okay? It sounds like a buzzy noise on this side. Is there a buzzing? Is it okay? You're right, Marilyn, everybody there? Val, you're okay there? Billy? Oh, Billy's there. Okay. It was a very sad day. A very sad day. Another blow in the life of the fledgling church. Stephen, one of the seven Grecian Jews, the Jewish believers that had been chosen to oversee the fair distribution of money and food to both the Aramaic Jews and the Grecian Jewish believers, had died. He was a man full of grace and power, and he did many great miraculous wonders and miracles, signs amongst the people. But Stephen had been taken before the Sanhedrin, the same Sanhedrin that Peter and John were dragged in front of when they had been caught preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ and his resurrection. Stephen had been brought before the Sanhedrin on trumped up charges of the freed men had brought up, you know, untruths and things. And upon hearing the charges, if the Sanhedrin hadn't already learnt their lesson, when they asked Peter about what he'd said, The high priest asked Stephen if these charges are true. Stephen just takes this opportunity and he preaches the gospel of Jesus Christ to the Sanhedrin. At the end of his message, he says, "You stubborn people, you are uncircumcised at heart and deaf to the truth. Must you forever resist the Holy Spirit? That's what your ancestors did, and so do you. Name one prophet your ancestors didn't persecute. They even killed the ones who predicted the coming of the righteous one, the Messiah whom you betrayed and murdered. You deliberately disobeyed God's law, even though you received it from the hands of angels." And when the members of the Sanhedrin heard that, they were furious. And they, I like the way the Bible puts it, they gnashed their teeth. Can you imagine these guys? "How dare you?" But they grabbed him, they dragged him outside, and they stoned him. A sad day for the church. The first martyr. But that's not all. We also read on that day in Acts chapter 8, on that day that Stephen was stoned, a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem. It was so intense, that this persecution, that all but the apostles fled from Jerusalem and were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria. But hang on. Those words sound familiar. Judea and Samaria. Now, where have we heard those words before? Well, from none other than Jesus himself. If you go back to the beginning of Acts, Acts chapter 1, verse 8, Jesus tells his disciples that they need to wait in Jerusalem for the power of the Holy Spirit to come on them, and they will be his witnesses there in Jerusalem, in Judea, and all of Samaria. And now the church is under persecution. And Saul, who looked on approvingly at Stephen's stoning, is going from house to house, knocking on doors, searching for believers of the way, and throwing them, both men and women, into prison in an attempt to destroy the church. But despite this persecution being intense, from God's perspective, it was of course intentional. There was a purpose for it. We don't know, but maybe the believers in Jerusalem had got into, say, a sweet spot. They were comfortable in Jerusalem, sitting at the apostles' feet, listening to their teaching and listening to their words and fellowshipping with each other. They'd forgotten that the word needed to be spread further than just Jerusalem. The persecution and their scattering was now sowing the gospel like Jesus said it would. You can say that this episode of trials was part of Jesus' answer to the prayer that he prays in John chapter 17, where he prays for his disciples and for his believers. But I'm sure the apostles never thought to themselves that persecution was going to be the driving factor in the spread of the gospel message. But maybe that's why Paul wrote in Romans chapter 8, verse 28, that we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his good purpose. Even if it means we suffer persecution, it won't be in vain, because we're called according to God's good purpose. To the devil's disgust, the persecution didn't kill the message. It only served to enhance the power of it. Because as we read in verse 4, those who had been scattered preached the word wherever they went. Those were the believers. Those 5,000 odd people in Jerusalem who had responded to the gospel of Jesus Christ, to the message of God's love through Jesus' death and forgiveness of sins. You know how the saying goes, wind increases the flame. You don't just put a fire out by waving your hands. Persecution can also be seen as a means of God purging his church. Like a winnowing fork, when you put it into the hay and throw it up, blows out the wheat husks. So persecution sifts the church of the fakers from the true believers. And as believers in Jesus, we have to expect persecution. As Paul writes in, about it in 2 Timothy 3, verse 12. But the way we respond to it is what matters. We've got to respond to it with biblical hope, just as those believers in Jerusalem did. Now, the first seven chapters of Acts that we've walked through deal with the mission work of the apostles amongst the Jews in Jerusalem. Now it moves further afield, and we see Philip in Samaria. Not Philip the apostle, but Philip, one of the seven Grecian Jews who was chosen. He's commonly known as Philip the evangelist. But he had gone down to a city in Samaria, province where the Samaritans lived. And we all remember the parable that Jesus told about the Good Samaritan. The Samaritans and the Jews hated each other. You could almost liken it to the feud between the Capulets and the Montagues in Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet, or the Catholics and the Protestants in Northern Ireland a number of years back. You understood that reference. Back in the days of Rehoboam, in 1 Kings, Israel was made up of 10 of the 12 tribes of Israel. They were in the northern kingdom. And Judah was the other two tribes, the two remaining tribes, and they made up the southern kingdom. Samaria became the capital of the north. And when Jeroboam became king of the north, he changed the worship. He said, no longer do you have to travel to Jerusalem to make your worship and to make your sacrifices and to worship God. Instead, he set up idols in Dan and Bethel, where they were to worship. And then a little while later, when Israel fell to the Assyrians, the people in the north began to intermarry with them, which was contrary to what God's word said in Deuteronomy chapter 7. So the Jews of the south hated the Samaritans of the north, and they called them dogs and half-breeds, because now they were no longer the pure race, the pure breed, the pure people of God. And hence the conflict in the parable that Jesus taught about the Samaritan and the Jews. The Samaritans and the Jews just didn't associate with each other. But Jesus walked through Samaria. And he stopped at Sychar, and he speaks with a woman who comes to draw water from the well in the middle of the day. We read that story in John chapter 4. And the woman tells Jesus that our fathers worshipped on this mountain here. But you Jews claim that the place we must worship is in Jerusalem. And then Jesus, speaking prophetically, says to her, a time is coming when it won't matter where one worships, as true worshippers will worship in spirit and in truth. And now we have Philip taking that true worship, the gospel of Jesus Christ, that he had died for the sins of all, to Samaria. But when the crowds heard Philip speak and saw the miraculous signs that he did, they all paid close attention to what he said. And just like at Pentecost, the Holy Spirit got the attention of the people, and they were receptive to the gospel message. Possessed people were delivered. Paralytics and cripples were healed, just as Jesus said would happen. Back in John chapter 14, there was great joy in that city. But, and here is another seed of destruction that the devil tries to sow into the early church, a religious falseness. There was one man who escaped detection, Simon. He was a sorcerer, and this area had been under the control of his evil thumb for a long time. So much so that people, both high and low, said of him that this man is the divine power, known as the great power. They'd positioned him almost as a god among them. The crowds followed him because they were amazed by his magic. That was until Peter arrived. The evangelist started preaching Christ and the forgiveness of sins, and it was no match for Simon the sorcerer. The multitudes that had been following Simon When they heard the good news from Philip, they turned from Simon and they believed in Christ and were baptized. Simon himself believed and was baptized. And he followed Philip wherever Philip went. And Simon was amazed at the great signs and the wonders that he saw Philip perform. The one who the people thought was amazing was now amazed himself. Unfortunately, it seems as though he wasn't amazed by God's grace. Now, the New Testament language doesn't always distinguish between believing and professing to believe. But from what we read in Acts chapter 8 from verse 14 to 24, it tells us that Simon's profession was fake. Peter and John, who were Jewish, were sent by the apostles in Jerusalem to go as emissaries to show that the church is united. So they go off to Samaria to validate the reports of the Samarians' conversions. And it was there that they laid hands on the believers and for them to receive the Holy Spirit. And it's this that Simon the sorcerer wanted to buy. Maybe he wanted it as a means to further his own agenda or to attract the crowds back to him that were now following Philip. But Peter was incensed that this man thought that the gift of God could be bought. And he said to him, "May your money perish with you." And it makes you wonder about his profession of faith in Jesus. Was it at all genuine? Because when you look at the things that Peter says to him, it makes you wonder. "Your heart is not right before God. Repent of this wickedness. You are full of bitterness and captive to sin." To someone who's made a genuine commitment to God, their heart would be right with God. They would have repented of their wickedness and now be full of the joy of the Lord, no longer slaves to sin. Yes, Simon believed, but it was not with his heart. See, false professions of faith didn't plague just the fledgling church back then, but they're still around today. Many people, in the heat of the moment, get caught up in the euphoria and they make a head commitment to follow Christ. And these are the commitments that begin to wane when the lights and the music fade and life returns to normal again. See, a true commitment to following Christ isn't made with a head, but it's made with a heart. When the Holy Spirit speaks to you and your hardened heart begins to thaw and you realize your nothingness compared to the fullness that Christ offers. When you acknowledge your own depravity and sinfulness and the absolute need that you have for a Savior to take you out of that. And when you understand that salvation cannot be bought, but it is a free gift through the death of God's only begotten Son. And when you accept that gift and the healing that it brings to your life. And when your life shows a change that only God can bring about through the inner working of His Holy Spirit. That is what true commitment is. What a true commitment is. And in this passage, we see the power of providence, the wisdom and foresight of God at work. Yep. He uses the opposition of the early church as a means to advance the cause of the gospel. He raises up the seven Greek-speaking Christians that would be accepted more easily in the other provinces than the Jews themselves, because there would be less antagonism against the Greek-speaking Jews Christians. He uses the pre-saved Paul, who becomes Paul, to push the believers out of Jerusalem, to fulfill Jesus' words of being witnesses not only in Jerusalem, but in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the world. And he causes the early believers to depend more on him and the gifts that he has given, rather than just sitting at the apostles' feet the whole time, listening to them. And he uses a false believer to show that the gift of grace cannot be bought. This lockdown we're faced for 94 days today is a testament of God's providential action using opposition to advance his cause. Many thought that when the lockdown was announced, that when we were going to be confined to our homes, that the churches would close. Yeah, the buildings closed. They were locked up. But that's not stopped his word. In fact, it has spread the gospel of Jesus Christ even further as we've used social media to bring the message to those who would normally meet within the buildings. And that message has not only gone out to those folk, but they've shared it further, and they've shared it further. So the message has gone out. The message of God's love and forgiveness and salvation through Jesus Christ has spread more than it's ever done before at this time. Stearns asked me on Friday, as we met for prayer, he said, "So gaan jy aanhou met wat jy begin het?" Referring to the various activities that we're doing via social media. And I replied, yes. Despite the opportunity to gather like this still, now that we can do this, we're still going to be videoing the services and putting it out on YouTube so that those that can't come still have the opportunity to gather around his word. As the restrictions are slowly lifted and we're allowed to visit each other in smaller numbers, the cell group that we have going via WhatsApp is still going to continue because it's meeting a need for so many folk. And the thought for the day that goes out in the morning will continue because for many, that's their start for the day with the Lord. What about you? What about you? What opposition in your life have you encountered over the last 94 days? Have you seen it as a hindrance to your relationship with Christ? Maybe now is the time for you to take a look at that opposition in your life as an opportunity that God is giving you to move out of maybe a comfort zone. Maybe the gift that God has given you is not being used to its full potential, and you need to move to allow God the opportunity to use you and that gift to his glory. Maybe it's a time to strengthen your commitment and your relationship with the Father. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we so often think of opposition and persecution as being the end of things. But Lord, in this passage we've seen today that your word is still reigns supreme, that your word still goes out, that you use the opposition we face, you use the persecution, and you use the hard times to spread your word even further. And Father, thank you that through social media at this time, not only here in Kippersol, not only here in Mpumalanga or South Africa or Africa, but in the world, because of social media, your message is going out to the world. A message of love, a message of forgiveness, a message of grace, a message of acceptance through the blood of Jesus. Father, whatever we're experiencing within our own lives, opposition that we have, maybe things that we're struggling with, Father, let us look at that opposition. Maybe as an opportunity that you're giving to us to move out of a place where we've been comfortable into a place where you want us to grow. And Father, for the gifts that you've given to us, we pray that we would use them to their full potential. Holy Spirit, give us the power and the strength to move out of our comfort zones that we've built over these last days. To move out, to use your gift to your glory. And Father, for many of us, we've had the opportunity to strengthen our commitment and our relationship with you over these last days, being in close proximity with each other, with our families, being able to study your word more diligently. But Father, maybe there are some of us that have taken this time to do other things, Father, we ask you to strengthen our commitment and our relationship with you. Holy Spirit, empower us again. Fill us afresh so that we can be the disciples that you called us to be, to spread your love, to spread your peace, but above all, to spread the knowledge of the saving grace of Jesus Christ and the grace that only the Father has. So Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, fill us, walk with us, guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. To God be the glory, great things he has done. Not only in the time that we can spend meeting together here this morning, but in the things that he's done in our lives over these past days. So let's join together as we sing the medley there, To God Be the Glory.
To God be the glory, to God be the glory, to God be the glory, great things he has done. To God be the glory, to God be the glory, to God be the glory, great things he has done. Majesty, worship his majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority, flow from his throne unto his own, his anthem raise. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship his majesty. Jesus who died, now glorified as King of all kings. And sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Yes, Heavenly Father, how great thou art, that we could gather here this morning to fellowship with one another and to hear your word. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you, now and until Jesus decides to come again in all his glory to collect those who love him. So go in peace, and let the God of peace go with each and every one of you. Amen. Join in now unto him.
Now unto him who is able to keep, able to keep us from falling, and present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty. Dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.
May you all have a beautiful, blessed day, and we'll see you again next Sunday. Amen.